In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God's Word talks about bread, and it speaks of it almost from the very start. It takes only three chapters to get to bread as a subject for us to think about and appreciate. From the first description, bread is described as a source of food that must be worked for. Moses' words, inspired by the Holy Spirit, identify bread by name, and then talk about how it follows the consequences of Adam's desire to be like God. God said, "By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return." According to God's curse, bread is connected with toilsome labor. As our Holy Gospel this morning begins, we see that the crowds were paying close attention to Jesus after he offered them a surplus of bread for which they did not labor or toil. John writes, "On the next day, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into boats and went to Capernaum seeking him." Their watching of these small details points to how closely they're watching Jesus and how much value they place on being in his presence. And this appears to be quite noble. In observing that he had not gone out to sea in the boat with his disciples, some in this crowd no doubt perceived that another miracle had taken place. It is at this point in Jesus' earthly ministry that his popularity was quite high, and that is driven by the amazing miracles that he worked. With another great crowd now coming to Capernaum, he uses this opportunity to point to why the crowds gather around him and to show them the true reason for his coming into this world. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Well, rather than recounting his miraculous walk out on the water, he rebukes them and the reasons for their seeking him out. "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves." He cautions them against the danger of seeking the gift over and above its giver. We today are also often guilty of looking to God and expecting him to open his hand to provide all that we want. In our faith, we pray for that which we desire, trusting that every good and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights. This is fitting and appropriate. But then, when he sees fit to call us to wait for whatever we're asking for, or if he chooses to never provide it at all, in our sin we see him as the giver who owes us gifts. We are looking to him for things that we have decided are important or desirable or necessary. We are looking at him in ways not provided for us in his word, but by our own definition of who we think he should be. This sharp rebuke he gives to those who sought him at Capernaum is the same rebuke we need to hear when we live this way. If we see him as anything other than the source of all that we have and are, including, of course, the promise of our forgiveness, then we need to be corrected. They did not recognize the reason for which he entered our world and were distracted by the amazing signs and miracles he provided. Such a view will destroy our faith from within, offering no nourishment, but only a separation from the God who knows us and loves us. And one of the most common sources of such a view is the very problem that Jesus soon addresses with the crowd. Following that rebuke, they receive a picture of what repentance looks like. He tells them, "Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Turning away from a false view of Jesus Christ involves looking at him the way he shows himself through his word. He opens his hand and he gives us all that we need. He points this crowd not to any security found within this broken world, but instead to a food that endures to eternal life, which he alone can provide. He points to his status as the Christ, the Messiah, the one whom the Father sent to bring about the forgiveness of all who would believe by his grace in his saving work. They said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." Unfortunately, the desire to play a part in our salvation or in showing ourselves as worthy of salvation is quite strong. When it comes to these things, we want to have our bread and eat it too. Not only is the Lord the sole source of this eternal gift of salvation, but those who receive it play no active role in the process, not unlike those who ate the free bread that he had recently provided. This crowd wants more as they follow Jesus around, but now they think they can work for it. If, as the sinful heart foolishly desires, we are able to attain eternal life for ourselves by something that we do, as the crowd implies with their question, then we also see ourselves as entitled to have that which we want God to give us. Again, this kind of thinking offers no nourishment at all to our status as believers. Showing himself once more to be the source of forgiveness, life, and salvation, the one who does and completes the work needed for us to be saved from our sin, Jesus offers one more clear teaching on how sinners are saved. He points to saving faith as a work of God, a gift of the Holy Spirit that comes from outside of us to bring us healing, peace, and relief. This is the true nourishment, and this is what he offers us even now in the divine service, as he shares with us his body and his blood in the bread and wine of Holy Communion. But these words of Jesus are not received well. They said to him, "Then what sign do you do, that we may see you and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." God first told Adam that following his sin, he would eat bread only by the sweat of his brow. In the wilderness, following Israel's doubting of God's plan and ability to hand over to them the promised land, they wandered for 40 years of punishment. To sustain their lives, however, God offered them bread every morning in the form of manna. They did no work to obtain it, and yet it was there for them each day. Now Jesus is faced with a challenge from this crowd for him to produce a sign to prove his status as the Christ, and he is being pointed back to the free bread that was given to Israel. In his response, he shows them something truly amazing. "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They respond, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." He shows them himself. He speaks of himself as the bread of life. He gave free bread to the crowd that followed him now to Capernaum. Here they are and they want a sign, and he gives of himself to offer that sign. He laid down his life for the world, and from his altar he freely shares with us what he gave up and shed at Calvary. We eat his body, we drink his blood, knowing that it gives us true nourishment in both body and soul, sustaining us in the one true faith, and providing a preview of the feast that waits for us in the new creation. This is far better than the manna the crowd wanted as they look back at God's open hand. In this holy meal, we are fed and nourished in our greatest need, and it comes to us, as Jesus shows, by no merit or worthiness in us. It comes instead by his toilsome labor on the cross. The crowd at Capernaum wanted to see another miracle like what they had just seen. Instead, they are pointed to Jesus as the Christ and as the source of the life-giving bread that comes freely to all who believe by his grace. Bread is identified by God as the food of work, which we can eat only after we labor for it. Here in this passage, Jesus shows himself to be the bread of life that comes down from heaven, and he calls us into his presence to receive the fruit of his work for us. As we do this, having examined the many ways that we sinfully desire to be like God and take his place, we know that he in fact took our place at the cross to free us from the fruit of our sin. In doing this for us, he readies us for eternal life with him in his perfect love in a day that never ends, at the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom. Amen. We stand and together confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son.